thinking of Raymond and Sarah Jane Spruce. I once was lost, but now am found. Amazing Grace.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents Billy Summers, a novel by Stephen King. Read by Paul Sparks.
Chapter 1. 1. Billy Summers sits in the hotel lobby, waiting for his ride. It's Friday noon. Although he's reading a digest-sized comic book called Archie's Pals and Gals, he's thinking about Emile Zola and Zola's third novel, his breakthrough, Thérèse Raquin. He's thinking it's very much a young man's book. He's thinking that Zola was just beginning to mine what would turn out to be a deep and fabulous vein of ore. He's thinking that Zola is the nightmare version of Charles Dickens. He's thinking that would make a good thesis for an essay. Not that he's ever written one. At 12:02, the door opens and two men come into the lobby. One is tall, with black hair combed in a 50s pompadour. The other is short and bespectacled. Both are wearing suits. All of Nick's men wear suits. Billy knows the tall one from out west. He's been with Nick a long time. His name is Frank McIntosh. Because of the pomps, some of Nick's men call him Frankie Elvis, or, now that he has a tiny bald spot in back, Solar Elvis. But not to his face. Billy doesn't know the other one. He must be local. McIntosh holds out his hand. Billy rises and shakes it. Hey, Billy, been a while. Good to see you.
Good to see you too, Frank.
This is Paulie Logan.
Hi, Paulie.
Billy shakes with the short one.
Pleased to meet you, Billy.
McIntosh takes the Archie Digest from Billy's hand. Still reading the comics, I see.
Yeah, Billy says. Yeah, I like them quite a bit. The funny ones. Sometimes the superheroes, but I don't like them as much.
McIntosh breezes through the pages and shows something to Paulie Logan.
Look at these chicks. Man, I could jack off to these.
Betty and Veronica, Billy says, taking the comic back. Veronica is Archie's girlfriend, and Betty wants to be.
You read books, too?
Logan asks.
Some, if I'm going on a long trip, and magazines, but mostly comics.
Good. Good,
Logan says, and drops McIntosh a wink. Not very subtle, and McIntosh frowns, but Billy's okay with it.
You ready to take a ride?
McIntosh asks.
Sure. Billy tucks his digest into his back pocket. Archie and his bosomy gal pals.
There's an essay waiting to be written there, too, about the comfort of haircuts and the attitudes that don't change, about Riverdale and how time stands still there.
Then let's go, McIntosh says. Nick's waiting.
2. McIntosh drives. Logan says he'll sit in back because he's short. Billy expects them to go west because that's where the fancy part of town is, and Nick Majerian likes to live large, whether home or away, and he doesn't do hotels. But they go northeast instead. 2 miles from downtown, they enter a neighborhood that looks lower middle class to Billy, 3 or 4 steps better than the trailer park he grew up in, but far from fancy. No big gated houses. Not here. This is a neighborhood of ranch houses with lawn sprinklers twirling on small patches of grass. Most are one story. Most are well maintained, but a few need paint, and there's crabgrass taking over some of the lawns. He sees one house with a piece of cardboard blocking a broken window. In front of another, a fat man in Bermuda shorts and a wife beater sits in a lawn chair from Costco or Sam's Club, drinking a beer and watching them go by. Times have been good in America for a while now, but maybe that is going to change. Billy knows neighborhoods like this. They are a barometer, and this one has started to go down. the people who live here are working the kind of jobs where you punch a clock. McIntosh pulls into the driveway of a two-story with a patchy lawn. It's painted a subdued yellow. It's okay, but it doesn't look like a place where Nick Majerian would choose to live, even for a few days. It looks like the kind of place a machinist or lower echelon airport employee would live, with his coupon-clipping wife and two kids making mortgage payments every month and bowling in a beer league on Thursday nights. Logan opens Billy's door. Billy puts his Archie Digest on the dashboard and gets out. McIntosh leads the way up the porch steps. It's hot outside, but inside it's air-conditioned. Nick Majerian stands in the short hallway leading down to the kitchen. He's wearing a suit that probably cost almost as much as a monthly mortgage payment on this house. His thinning hair is combed flat. No pompadour for him. His face is round and Vegas tanned. He's heavy set, but when he pulls Billy into a hug, that protruding belly feels as hard as stone.
"Billy!"
Nick exclaims and kisses him on both cheeks. Big, hearty smacks. He's wearing a million-dollar grin.
"Billy, Billy, man! It's good to see you!"
"Good to see you too, Nick."
He looks around.
"You usually stay somewhere fancier than this."
He pauses.
"If you don't mind me saying."
Nick laughs. He has a beautiful, infectious laugh to go with the grin. McIntosh joins in, and Logan smiles.
"I got a place over on the west side. Short-term, house-sitting, you could call it. There's a fountain in the front yard. Got a naked little kid in the middle of it. There's a word for that."
"Cherub," Billy thinks but doesn't say. He just keeps smiling.
"Anyway, a little kid peeing water, you'll see it. You'll see it. No, this one isn't mine, Billy. It's yours. If you decide to take the job, that is."
3. Nick shows him around.
"Fully furnished," he says, like he's selling it. Maybe he sort of is.
This one has a second floor, where there are 3 bedrooms and 2 bathrooms. The second small, probably for the kids. On the first floor, there's a kitchen, a living room, and a dining room that's so small it's actually a dining nook. Most of the cellar has been converted into a long, carpeted room with a big TV at one end and a ping-pong table at the other. Track lighting. Nick calls it the rumpus room, and this is where they sit. McIntosh asks them if they'd like something to drink. He says there's soda, beer, lemonade, and iced tea.
"I want a Arnold Palmer," Nick says. "Half and half, lots of ice."
Billy says that sounds good. They make small talk until the drinks come. The weather, how hot it is down here in the border south. Nick wants to know how Billy's trip in was. Billy says it was fine, but doesn't say where he flew in from, and Nick doesn't ask. Nick says, "How about that fucking Trump?" And Billy says, "How about him?" That's about all they've got. But it's okay, because by then McIntosh is back, with 2 tall glasses on a tray, and once he leaves, Nick gets down to business.
"When I called your man Bucky, he tells me you're hoping to retire."
"I'm thinking about it. Been at it a long time. Too long."
"Truth. How old are you anyway?"
44.
"Been doing this ever since you took off the uniform."
"Pretty much." He's pretty sure Nick knows all this.
"How many in all?"
Billy shrugs. "I don't exactly remember. It's 17. 18 counting the first one, the man with the cast on his arm."
"Bucky says you might do one more if the price was right."
He waits for Billy to ask. Billy doesn't, so Nick resumes.
"The price on this one is very right. You could do it, spend the rest of your life someplace warm, drinking pina coladas in a hammock."
He busts out the big grin again.
$2 million. $500,000 up front, the rest after."
Billy's whistle isn't part of the act, which he doesn't think of as an act, but as his dumb self. The one he shows to guys like Nick and Frank and Polly. It's like a seatbelt. You don't use it because you expect to be in a crash, but you never know who you might meet coming over a hill on your side of the road. This is also true on the road of life,
where people veer all over the place and drive the wrong way on the turnpike.
Why so much? The most he's ever gotten on a contract was 70K. It's not a politician, is it?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.